Everybody, welcome to Geekend. It's the IT World weekly series where we talk about things to do for the next coming weekend with a geeky bent. Joining me as always is Phil Johnson, Associate Online Editor at ITworld.com. Phil, how you doing?
I'm doing great, Keith. How are you?
Good. We have a special episode this week because it's a double issue. We've got a double issue, a double episode, because next week I'm off. I'm taking the week of 4th of July off, but I'm sure like pretty much 90% of the country is as well. It's one of those weird weeks where 4th of July lands on a Thursday, and so you take the beginning of the week off, the end of the week off, that kind of stuff, right?
Yeah, it's kind of a drag. I guess Wednesday would be a little worse, but yeah. Not a good time for the holiday.
Are you planning on working, or are you going to just kind of work?
Next week?
Yeah.
Oh, well, my boss is watching this, so I'll definitely be working.
There you go. Let's just get right into some stuff to do for the, you know, kind of the next two weekends. You could consider kind of 4th of July as one long weekend anyway, so let's just see what's out there. In terms of movies this week, not a lot of great geeky technology type movies. The two big movies are The Heat with Sandra Bullock and Melissa McCarthy, kind of like a buddy cop flick, but with two women. My wife has seen this trailer, and she loves the trailer. Because it takes place in Boston. She's a big fan of people that are trying to do Boston accents. And apparently Melissa McCarthy does a really good one in this one. So there's kind of that Boston local angle as well. And she loved Miss Congeniality with Sandra Bullock, so she's a huge fan of Sandra Bullock. So I might end up having to go to that movie. I'd love to see that. The other one is White House Down with Channing Tatum. Action adventure, White House blowing up terrorists. It seems like this movie's already been out. There was one like maybe 3 or 4 months ago, but I guess if you're into that as well, right?
Yeah, that's an option. That one hasn't grabbed me too much either, but yeah, they're doing a lot of press for that right now.
Yeah, so the big one is next weekend, because there are two movies that should appeal to the geek. What are those two movies again, Phil?
You got Despicable Me 2, opens up on the 3rd, the sequel to obviously Despicable Me. And then you got The Lone Ranger opening on the same day with Johnny Depp playing Tonto and who plays The Lone Ranger? I forget.
Armie Hammer.
Armie Hammer, right.
Well, yep. It's a great name, but I can't remember like if he's been in other movies that I've seen.
Yeah, no, it's one of those names you recognize, but I have trouble pulling up what he's actually been in. But yeah, those both look definitely worth checking out, I think. I love Despicable Me. I don't know about you, but I thought that was really a lot of fun. I saw that with my kids, and we all really enjoyed that last Steve Carell. It was just great, but it was done very well, so I'm looking forward to checking this one out.
Yeah, I didn't see that in... I don't think I remember seeing that in the movie theater, but once it came out on DVD, I think we caught it, and my kids absolutely love it, too. They love the Minions. They love the little girls. I mean, you know, I've seen that movie now probably 8 or 9 times because the kids keep popping that into the DVD player. So, yes, they're excited about that one. In fact, for my son's birthday, we got them. They're coming out with toys now related to Despicable Me. They've got like Minion toys and other things, but they've actually got the fart gun. And I was actually I was going to bring it in to show you, but I forgot to bring it in this morning. But there was that scene in the movie where he goes, "I said dart gun," and it turns out that the scientist made a gun that makes the fart sound. So of course the marketing people for the movie actually made it, and so it is the funniest thing. It gets kind of old after probably about an hour of listening to it, but it's a great gag gift.
That's great. Well, I'll tell you what. Next, when we're together again, you can bring the fart gun, and I'm going to bring. We have a little noisemaker thing that makes the fart sounds that my girls love, so we can have a little fart sound machine.
A fart gun sound off or fart sound gun off.
I also read that I guess they're going to do a movie with the Minions supposedly coming out next year. Did you hear that?
I did not hear that. That was news to me. Do you think that the Minions have appeal on their own?
I was just talking to my 10-year-old about it this morning, and she was like, I was thinking she'd be excited, and she said, what are they going to do for a whole movie with them? And I said, I have no idea. So it does seem like it might be a little tough to stretch that one out, but who knows?
Yeah, I mean, you know, on the DVD, they had mini movies, and so they were able to do small little kind of like vignettes and stories around them. But after a while, kind of the gibberish language that they use kind of gets annoying after a while. So I'm not so sure about that. But you know, again, you know, maybe that's marketed more towards kids than to adults.
Yeah.
Let's just jump on the Lone Ranger thing for a second. Do you think this movie is going to appeal to people that might not know who the Lone Ranger was or remembers the original TV series?
Man, that's a long time ago. I mean, I think there's just a lot of people that know the name, but probably never actually seen any Lone Ranger movies or the TV show or anything like that. So, in that sense, it could be good because, you know, you're starting from scratch almost with a lot of people.
Yeah.
They know the name, but they don't really know anything else about it. So that could be, it could work out pretty well that way. And with those big names in it, you know, it's going to draw some crowds, obviously. So we'll see.
Yeah, what's interesting is that my son, who's only six, is really excited about seeing the Lone Ranger again because it's cowboys, Indians, guns, the westerns, and it's not like we've you know, kind of raised him on any of this stuff. I guess the closest thing you could say would be Toy Story with Woody, terms of the cowboys and Indians angle. But you know, there's a tie-in with the Legos, and he got the Lego train set for the Lone Ranger. So you know, maybe that's you know, that's the appeal. And then he's seen the trailer for the movie, and he really wants to go see this movie. The problem is it's PG-13, and I'm just like, oh, if it was only PG, I could probably take him. But with PG-13, I'm a little wary.
Yeah, you got to be careful with that. I mean, I always, with movies like that, I'll literally go on to like IMDb and check out. They'll tell you what got it the rating that it did. So it's always kind of a good heads up that way. But yeah, it's interesting. You know, there's obviously not many cowboy movies in general anymore, obviously. So it'll be interesting to see how it goes.
Right. The last big one was, I think, Cowboys versus Aliens.
Oh yeah.
Which I didn't go see that either.
I saw that. We watched that not that long ago, finally on demand, and it was okay. It was worth pulling up on demand. I wouldn't have wanted to have paid, you know, $10 or whatever to go see it in the theater, but it was kind of fun.
Right. And now we did this last week when we were talking about Brad Pitt in terms of geeky or technology related movies with Johnny Depp. Do you think that he's been in any kind of, you know, geek related movies, or because we were having a hard time trying to figure that out too.
Yeah, I think he's got a little more of a more of his movies have a little more geek factor than Brad Pitt. I mean, Brad Pitt, we were definitely scraping more. I mean, Johnny Depp, you've got Edward Scissorhands, you've got Rango, you've got even Ed Wood was, you know, a little geeky kind of movie there. So it's definitely a little more of a geek resume for his flicks than for Brad Pitt, I'd say.
Yeah, I think that he tends to be in more quirky movies. I think you could kind of qualify him as a quirky actor, especially when he works with Tim Burton. So, you know, again, with geek being such a general term, and you can narrow down into niche segments, that you could say that if you're a kind of a Tim Burton fan, then Johnny Depp is you know, one of the people that you follow.
Yeah, for sure. And I was just looking at my notes again about what he was in, and you had Dark Shadows, obviously, pretty recently.
Yeah.
Kind of go the geek route on that one. He was even in an episode of SpongeBob. So if you like SpongeBob,
was he playing himself, or did they come up with like an aquatic name for him?
Like
Johnny Fish,
no,
or something
playing
like that.
Himself. I don't know what character he was playing, but he did appear in one episode a few years back. So that's some geek cred right there.
There you go. All right, moving on from movies into the big 4th of July holiday. You know, we do know for a fact that you are a big fan of grilling and barbecues.
Yep. I love working the grill. It's one of my favorite things, especially in the summer. Standing out there over the heat, have a beer, grill up some meat. It's great. I love it. One of my favorite things.
All right, but we're gonna kind of geekify this. So, what, you know, if you don't like to go outdoors a lot, or if you haven't kind of gotten into this whole grilling barbecue thing, what are some ways where you can add some geek cred to your barbecue grilling?
Oh, well, there's really no end to the ways you can geek up your barbecue grilling setup. You know, I was doing a little research on this because I'm actually going to write about it next week on ITworld. And there's kind of an endless list of geek accoutrements you can get for grilling. Lots of geek aprons, superhero aprons, there's a whole set of those you can get. I found a nice apron that it's got all sorts of... It'll let you hold every single cooking utensil you could possibly use.
Oh, that's nice, yeah.
It's called the Tactical Barbecue Apron. That looks pretty geeky and pretty useful. There's things like, I found a really cool spatula that's got a built-in thermometer with it, so you can stick that in the meat as you're looking to flip it over and things like that, so that's a little nerdy right there. But the most, I think the most fertile set of geek grilling stuff was all tied to Star Trek. and there's a million Star Trek things that you could get. You know, again, aprons. There's lots of different Star Trek salt and pepper shakers. Star Trek, let's see, there were flasks, there were drinking glasses you could break out, bottle openers shaped like the Enterprise.
Yep.
There's kind of no end to the thing, kind of things you can go out and get to make things just a little geekier out on the patio.
The geekiest thing that I have related to food is a Enterprise pizza wheel. So you can cut the pizza.
That.
Yeah, so I've got one of those, but I don't have any of the kind of the barbecue. It works as well as all the other ones that you use. You know, after a while, you're like, you know, you're just kind of...
Yeah.
You're like, oh, come on, just cut this darn pizza.
Nothing about it then, functionally.
Yeah, you know, barbecue aprons. I'm not really kind of sold on this idea yet. Now, you're a grilling guy. Is it a requirement that you wear some sort of apron? Because I've always, you know, I'd always be afraid of wearing the one that says, like, you know, kiss the chef or kiss the cook. Yep. Those seem to be kind of out of bounds for people to wear, but I guess if you have a Star Trek apron, it's okay. Or why do you need an apron when you're barbecuing?
Well, splatter factor.
Okay.
You know, it can definitely get a little messy depending on what you're cooking.
The sauces and the marinades and things like that.
Yeah, or just fat, you know, spraying up on you. I actually usually wear an apron when I'm out there. You know, if we've got guests over and I've got kind of some nice clothes on, I want to keep that covered up. But
you're supposed to dress up when you're barbecuing?
No, you know, sometimes we have friends come for barbecues, and I'll put on a nicer shirt or a shirt, and want to you know, keep the grease off me. Definitely not required, but
okay.
You know, for those of you who want to put one on, there's lots of things to choose from in the geek realm.
I do like the idea of kind of having all of the tools in different pockets, because that's kind of, I know that when I've been grilling, you know, you've got the thing that scrapes the metal part, the scraper, I call
brush.
It the brush.
Yeah.
Thank you. Then you've got a spatula and you've got your tongs or, you know, and your forks. Never knowing where to put them, it's kind of a good idea to have those in the pockets.
Looks pretty handy. I may have to consider getting that. We'll see. But, yeah, it's a good idea.
All right, one final question for you on the barbecue front. Propane versus charcoal.
I love charcoal. I do most of it on propane just for the convenience. You know, it's a lot easier, especially after a day of work. Come home, fire up the gas grill. But I do break out the charcoal pretty regularly too, just to mix it up on the weekends.
Is there a difference in taste with the meat?
Yeah, I think I like the charcoal generally better, but I'm pretty happy with the gas too. But it's definitely, the convenience factor is pretty high with the gas.
All right, so we've got two more ideas that we wanted to chat about of things to do over the next couple of weekends. The first thing is you're planning an IKEA visit, aren't you?
Yeah, I got to go to IKEA and buy some furniture for the house, just some functional things we need. And I know we were trying to figure out if there's a geek angle to IKEA, and I don't think it really comes to mind when you think of geeky places to go, but there's something about the way they engineer everything so that you can put it together, so that anybody can put any of this stuff together with the minimal amount of tools. That's, I think, kind of interesting the way they've figured out how to do that. It's not a lot of fun all the time, but there's something interesting about that whole system they've worked out.
Yeah, I've never been to an IKEA. I think they're not really close to us. The closest I've gotten are just, you know, gone to like Target to buy like a bookcase, and I've put together those types of things. But those always tend to be like at least an hour or two when you're putting this stuff together. And do you think that IKEA makes it easier and quicker to put this stuff together?
They've got it down to a science pretty well. I think they do a pretty good job of that, for sure. And I don't know how they figured that all out, but everything you get from there, they've got pretty simple instructions. It can still take a while depending what you got, but pretty simple.
All right, and the one thing that I'm going to do this weekend or this upcoming over the next couple of weekends is our local town carnival is showing up. And
great.
You know, you haven't lived until you've been to a local carnival where you can meet the carnies and get them to try to, you know, hear them try to tell you to, hey, play this game, play this game, play this game. A few years ago, I won a giant purple gorilla with that bottle cap game. And so I'm a big fan of kind of carnival games and trying to figure out which ones are trying to rip me off and which ones I can actually win.
Mm-hmm.
The best one I'm at is whack-a-mole. You can never beat me in whack-a-mole.
Oh, you're a whack-a-mole champ?
I am a whack-a-mole savant.
I had no idea.
Yes, it's probably from playing all the video games as a kid. I've got great hand-eye coordination. And you know, it's funny, I'll like stand around and see if they're, because the more people you get, the bigger chance you get for a bigger prize. So I look around for the, you know, like the kids or the parents who might not know what they're doing in terms of whack-a-mole, and then I jump in there at the end, and then, you know, I snag the prize. It is a little bit, yeah. And I used to be really good at the water gun game.
Oh, yeah.
You know, where you shoot the water and then you have a race up to the top.
Yep.
But I think those are fixed. I'm not convinced that.
Really?
Yeah, I'm a little convinced. I think that there's a button that the carny can push where, you know, he can pick pretty much who the winner is going to be.
Is this a story you want to break for us?
No, it's just more of a gut feeling, I think.
Oh. Let me ask, what was your favorite arcade game growing up? Play. Do you have a favorite?
Oh boy. You know, I finally learned a lot of the patterns in Ms. Pac-Man.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
And then when those Laserdisc games came out, do you remember Dragon's Lair? It
yep.
was like the cartoon. And so I learned how to play Space Ace, which was the sequel to that, and
okay.
I learned all the patterns on that one. So I could get really, really far in that game. But yeah, it was I spent a lot of time in arcades as well.
That's paying off now.
Yeah, exactly. All right, Phil, thanks for joining us on Geekend again this weekend. And everybody have a great weekend. Whatever you do, you know, keep it fun, keep it safe, and keep it geeky.
Have a great July 4th, everyone.
Bottom. Hilarious.